and welcome to another episode of the Fully Charged Plus podcast. It's going to be a great episode, this. I know you're going to enjoy it. It's been a real joy to make it. For the last 10 years, you know, every now and then this topic comes up of, you know, hydrogen is the future or batteries is the only answer and blah, blah, blah. And it's with this conversation is so good. It crystallizes those rather ridiculous differences in the sense that we're hugely reliant on both these technologies being an enormous success in the next 30, 40 years. We need both. And they are highly compatible. They can work with each other very, very effectively. And that is the joy of this episode. I just want to briefly state, because, you know, I've been very skeptical, and I don't think wrongly so, about hydrogen fuel cell passenger cars. And I've always wanted them to work. It's not that I don't want them to work. I would love them to work, but they don't work at the moment. And they really haven't developed to anything like the same extent as battery electric, and nor has the infrastructure for charging them. So when people say, I'm worried about where I'm going to charge my electric car, if you had a hydrogen car, you would really need to worry, because there isn't anywhere basically to fill them yet. And there may be one day, and I'd be so happy, genuinely so happy to be wrong. But what this discussion today takes it to a whole new level, because it focuses on the absolute appropriate aspect of where to use hydrogen technology. So today I'm talking to Lars Stenqvist, who is the CTO of Volvo Trucks. Now, I just want to clarify something, because I wasn't fully aware of this, but most of viewers and listeners to this show will be aware that Volvo, as we think of it, Volvo, was bought by Geely Holdings, a Chinese company, back in the 1990s. Well, that's Volvo Cars. It's very specifically the car part of Volvo. Volvo Trucks is still wholly owned, a Swedish company, owned and operated by Swedish people in your actual Sweden, based in your actual Gothenburg, on the western seaboard of Sweden. And it's an amazing place. I've been around their factories there. Amazing. I mean, it is a big company. So what Volvo Trucks do, obviously, they make trucks, quel surprise, but they also make buses. They make really huge trucks. They make quarrying equipment, diggers. They're already making battery-operated diggers. They're already making battery-operated trucks today. And so Lars and I discussed that whole area of what Volvo are doing. Really, really exciting. Really amazing stuff. I won't say any more about it. Before we dive into that great big hydrogen-powered mishmash of enjoyment, let's have a quick word from our fabulous Fully Charged Plus show podcast sponsors. My Energy is putting the I back into British innovation. My Energy is putting the I back into inventing the future. My Energy is putting the I back into inspiring a nation. Recharging the world with green smart energy. Charge your EV with your PV and more. Visit myenergy.com and help to spark the green revolution. My Energy. Driving the charge to a greener future. Well, that's fantastic. Thank you so much. I really want to thank our sponsors. I also want to thank our wonderful Patreons, who don't get a shout out often enough on the podcast, because, you know, that helps us enormously as well to produce these podcasts, which we love doing. But this one is a doozy. It's going to be really good. So please welcome on to the Fully Charged Plus podcast, Lars Stenqvist from Volvo Trucks. So Lars, this is such a great opportunity to speak to you. I just want to quickly say that I have been dreaming of coming to Sweden and seeing some very big electric and hydrogen trucks and plant diggers and things we're not allowed, but one day we'll get there. But I'm so excited to talk to you, because I think this is, I'll just quickly, very briefly explain my position on this, and I'm very happy to be corrected. But it feels to me like over the last 10 years, we have not seen the success of hydrogen fuel cell cars, passenger cars, and we've seen enormous success and development of battery electric cars. And we have seen a slow development of buses and trucks and bigger vehicles. But where you, as soon as you see hydrogen fuel cells in action in a big vehicle, it makes so much sense. That's my take at the moment. So I'm very happy. And I've just looked through your website, and you actually stipulate that you think battery electric vehicles for local deliveries, for urban stuff is, you know, that's the answer. It's when it gets to the bigger machinery that you have to talk about hydrogen. Am I miles off target or close?
No, Robert, you're definitely not miles off. But let me start with saying that there is definitely an open invitation for you, Robert, to come to Gothenburg to test drive some trucks. It would be an honor, absolutely.
Oh, that would be great.
But for us then in the Volvo Group, trucks, buses and construction equipment, then we believe that we need three technologies in parallel in order to go fossil free. For us, it's very, very important to have this statement, going fossil free. If we believe in a net zero economy by 2050, that means that we need to have a decarbonized rolling fleet 2050. And then it means, since we have our vehicles on the road for approximately 10 years, that 2050 turns to 2040 for us. So fossil free from 2040. For us, it's rather clear that we cannot rely only on the combustion engine, because simply there will not be enough biofuels available to decarbonize road transport completely. So for that reason, we have a very clear path going forward that the absolute majority of the vehicles will be electric. Right. We believe that they will be a combination or a mix of battery electric vehicles and, as you were into, fuel cell electric vehicles. And to start with, you can do the sort of division like you did. You could say that it's obvious that for, let's say, city applications like refuse trucks or city distribution, where you have a transport company with some kind of fixed route, you come home every evening, you can use the night to recharge your batteries, those vehicles will definitely be battery electric. And then we see clearly that the development of batteries goes fast, really fast. Mm-hmm. And we can expect, we will launch, we have today trucks up to 26 ton in operations. You know, we are in serial production for battery electric vehicles up to 26 ton for refuse trucks, for regional haul, for city distribution, etc. Next year, we will go up to 44 ton. So that's the big rigs then. Also battery electric then. And then with increased energy on board, you will get longer and longer range, longer possibilities to operate. But when you come from the other side, as you were into, truly heavy haul, then most likely fuel cell electric vehicles will be more beneficial. You will get longer range, shorter refueling time or recharging time. And most likely also then the weight of the vehicle will be much lower than a fully say charged battery electric vehicle and with a lot of batteries on board. So for those customers that are load sensitive from a weight perspective, they can get more cargo on board on their vehicle if they go fuel cell electric then.
Right.
So I normally say that they sort of meet each other in the middle. But that's only half of the answer, Robert, because we also believe that the big challenge going forward is about energy, energy distribution, cost of energy, and infrastructure. And if you talk about the big rigs, if you talk about charging, then we talk about charging with 350 kilowatts, 500 kilowatts, 750 kilowatts, up to 1 megawatt then.
Wow.
This year in Europe, you will have around 300,000 new vehicles registered. Means that you have a couple of million trucks rolling out there on the fleet. So if we then fast forward and think about that, we will have a lot of electric vehicles on the road. And if you just think about 1,000 of them, that's a very small fraction of the rolling fleet in 10, 20, 30 years that they want to charge simultaneously. Thousand vehicles charging simultaneously, and let's say 750 kilowatts. That's 750 megawatts that you need then power then to charge those vehicles simultaneously. Yeah. And that is the similar size to some of the nuclear reactors that we run in Sweden, just to get the magnitude right. So I believe, and we believe, that the power distribution, the grid, will definitely be one bottleneck going forward. Maybe not in Europe, maybe not in whole Europe, but in different parts of the world. So we see that hydrogen very, very well can play some kind of balancing game or balancing, be a balancing factor into this game as well. So we believe that there will be a lot of hydrogen, and most likely we will be in different parts of the world happy to have a combination of battery electric vehicles and fuel cell electric vehicles from an energy perspective.
Because that's, I mean, one of the things that has been really remarkable since I first took an interest in this. And in fact, I'm sure, you know, 10 or 11 years ago, I came to Gothenburg and saw some of the early electric cars that Volvo were making. It was an amazing experience always. Especially in the, I did come to the Arctic Circle once and drive an electric car. And I thought I knew what cold was, but I realized until I got there, I didn't. That was, I think it was about minus 38 the day I was there. So quite chilly, but
that's cold.
Yes, yeah. That is quite cold. Yeah. But the real change since then with batteries is cost. You know, if you think that it was around $1,200 from memory, around $1,200 in 2010, and it's around, I think, $140 per kilowatt hour pack price now. Amazing drop. So has something similar happened with fuel cells? Because I remember talking to Honda engineers about fuel cells in around 2009-10, and their concern was the expense that they were to make them small and light was a real challenge and expensive. But presumably you don't have that problem to the same extent with a truck or a big earth mover. You know, you've got much more weight to deal with anyway, so having a very small fuel cell isn't necessary. I mean, has that technology got cheaper or advanced to the same degree as batteries?
But you're right, Robert. It's not about small and light for us. It's about durability.
Yeah.
That is the challenge for our vehicles, of course. When you're talking about 40, 50, 60 ton, you talk about annual mileage of 100,000, 200,000, up to 300,000 kilometers. So to get those components to last is definitely then the challenge then. When it comes to the cost and the performance, we took a very, very important decision. We have formed a joint venture together with Daimler Trucks. Daimler Trucks and the Volvo Group, we are on the road, we are competitors.
Yeah.
But we have seen clearly that in order to get the right volumes for the right development and production of fuel cells, we needed to combine our volumes. We have created a joint venture, 50-50. We treat it as a sort of tier one supplier, meaning that we give them all the requirements. And from that joint venture called Cellcentric, we intend then to buy all the fuel cells to us and to Daimler Trucks. And by doing so, we have now created the necessary scale, the right necessary volume, both for development, but even more important, Robert, for production.
Yeah.
Because you need a very high volume in order to set up the production facilities in the right way, in order to get the costs down. We have very ambitious targets when it comes to the target cost for the fuel cells out of Cellcentric. But we are convinced that we together with this injection into this company, with the knowledge that we have injected, that we will manage to get them to the right cost level, meaning that we can then offer them to our customers then at an attractive total cost of ownership.
Right. Because I mean, the other thing that is, as you mentioned that, I do remember reading about the joint venture with Daimler. But the other one that is, I think I'm really asking this for the benefit of our listeners who may not be very well informed about electric motors themselves. But, you know, we're used to electric motors in cars and they're quite small, physically quite small. You know, and they have what, 50, 100, 200, 300 kilowatt power. And when you think about a truck, especially a big, heavy truck, I can't imagine how big the motor is. I'm assuming it's much, because I don't know how many horsepower a big truck has, but it must have a lot.
Well, let's say a heavy truck has, let's say, around 500 horsepower. You can get up to 700-800 horsepower down in a big rig down. So the corresponding size of the electrical motors is, of course, sizable then. The motors that we have in production today, for the smaller vehicles, we have the 200 kilowatt motors, and for the somewhat bigger ones, we use two of them up to 400 kilowatt then. But we have decided to utilize transmissions. I mean, you could have solved that by using an even then bigger motor then, but we have decided that the most efficient when it comes to installation and when it comes to the total cost of ownership is to run with rather, let's say, sizable but not enormous motors and combine it with the transmissions then. So it's rather interesting to see that the technology like transmission technology certainly belongs to the future.
Yes.
It's not belonging to the past.
Right. Yes, that's really interesting because so they effectively will have gears, the big trucks.
Yep. Yep.
Right, right. But I mean, would that be an automatic system? It wouldn't be, because I mean, the last time I went in a big truck, when I drove one for a TV show, you know, and I'm not allowed to drive one on the road, but all I remember was changing gear. That's all I did, you know, and this is a few years ago. So it had a lot of gears, that truck. So this would be an automatic system.
Yes, it's an automatic system then. So from a driver perspective, you won't even recognize it then. So it will shift gears automatically.
Right.
Absolutely.
But that's an interesting thing because that has become there were some of the very early electric cars did have one or two gears still. That was a thing that was, and now none of them do. So we're very not used to that, but I can understand how it makes much more sense for a truck. So then the other aspect is, I suppose, because that, it is the scale of it that fascinates and terrifies me. You know, I can sort of really picture a completely realistic charging network for cars. We're seeing it develop very rapidly, even in this country. There are, you know, large recharging hubs with 20 or 30 or 40 rapid chargers. And you know, that's a lot of electricity, but it's very manageable. But if you scale that up, say, for a trucks, where you've got a charging hub for 50 trucks, which is this kind of scale you'd need, that can take 750 kilowatts each. It is mind-boggling. I mean, it is, and that's just one hub that needs that. And you'd need 100 hubs like that, maybe more in this country, and you know, over Europe, thousands. That's a big shift.
Yeah, definitely. And we have made some calculations then in our industry association, ASEA, and we have said that until 2025, we have calculated that you need around 11,000 of those charging points
right.
for heavy-duty trucks, and 2030 up to around 40,000 charging points.
Right.
And we need to get this going now. It's a little bit, you know, chicken and egg discussion, or it can be a chicken and egg discussion. No electric trucks on the road, so no one dares to invest in a charging network, and no charging networks, so no electric trucks.
Yeah, yeah.
So for that reason, we took an initiative together with two of our competitors, then Traton Group, that's the Volkswagen part dealing with the commercial vehicles, and Daimler Trucks then. So the three of us together with the Volvo Group, we have said that we have the intention to set up a joint venture right. and start to roll out the pan-European network of charging points for fast charging them for heavy-duty trucks and buses then. We are not naive. We don't think that we will build all the charging yeah. stations across Europe. So we have said that we invest to start with. We think that we have financial muscles to build around 2,000 of these charging points to start with. I would not be surprised if others would knock on the door showing interest, so that it could be somewhat more going forward. But for us, this is more a sign of leadership, yeah. early leadership, someone paving the way, someone showing the rest of the world that it will happen.
Yeah.
So we would more than welcome that there are other consortia building, let's say, the rest of the network in parallel to what we are building. But it's extremely important that we get it going now. We need to roll it yeah. out. It's 2021, soon clocking to 2022 and 2025. We need to have, as I said, 11,000 charging points in Europe. Just.
Right. Because I'm sure you're in advanced talks about this and designing about this, but one of the things that impressed me there was that there's a brand new charging hub in Oxford and another one in Braintree with real multiple rapid charges, but a very large battery pack that is part of the whole system, which is the buffer really between the grid and the charger. And I'm assuming you're, because that is one way of mitigating these huge spikes of demand that you would get from trucks?
Yeah, we look into many different options and working then with many different suppliers as well. But I think that we will get used to see a lot of different options going forward. Some of them with these big buffers, the batteries as buffers, in order sort of to disconnect. In other areas, perhaps you have direct access, so you can really connect directly to the grid. I think it will be very much dependent on where you locate your charging points. Where do you need them?
Yeah. And then, I mean, the flip side to that is, you know, when you think about the expense of installing a system like that, the expense of installing hydrogen fuel pumps is quite high too. And we have, you know, in a sense, we have an electricity distribution system in Europe already. It exists. You know, there's already hundreds of wires. At the moment, there aren't hundreds of hydrogen. It's a very new technology, you know, in that sense, isn't it? So that's got to be, I presume, a long-term plan is how you get the hydrogen to the truck.
Yeah, definitely then. But then also such a charging network or refueling network then more than for hydrogen then. There are some advantages. It's much quicker to fill up a hydrogen truck. We're talking about 20 minutes approximately. Then you have much longer range. So also then referring to the same study coming out of our industry association, ASEA, stating that by 2025, around 500 charging points for hydrogen would be sufficient. And by 2030, if we have 1,000 charging points then, or refueling points for hydrogen, that would also be that would be suitable to the demand. So the magnitude in, let's say, numbers of charging points versus refueling points is very much in favor of hydrogen then.
Yeah.
And if I may there, Robert, a little bit of a side story on this with hydrogen, how to transport, how to distribute, etc. We have a very, very interesting collaboration partnership with one of the steel manufacturers, Ovako. Right. So they are producer of special steel. They are not producing virgin steel. They are using scrap steel to melt it down and then to treat it to their special alloys and their special qualities. They have decided as a company, Ovako has decided, we are going to go fossil free in our operations. Right. And today they are using propane in order to heat up the steel in their roll forming process. And they have made experiments with different kinds of solutions. And they have now then found a very, very good solution where they combine oxygen and hydrogen to heat up the steel.
Wow.
And then they have decided to have local production at their steel mill of hydrogen. So they will install an electrolyzer on the site in their steel plant, steel mill, and they will then crack water into hydrogen and oxygen. And here comes the beauty. When they made their calculations, they saw that the balance was that they needed this much oxygen and this much hydrogen, and they ended up with a surplus of hydrogen.
Wow.
So they called us. They called us and said, Volvo, hey, we know that you're working on fuel cell electric vehicles. Are you interested in a partnership with us? We could build a refueling station in very close proximity of our steel mill, where you can then charge or refuel your vehicles then. So we have a partnership now. They're going to start to build this electrolyzer. And we have the intention that we are going to refuel our fleet test, the test fleet of hydrogen vehicles there at their refueling station. And I don't think that they will be alone. I think that many other steel mills across the globe, across Europe, will come to the same conclusion. And then all of a sudden, most likely, you will get rather much local production of hydrogen across Europe. And by that, you most likely can build up an infrastructure for hydrogen refueling stations then connected to those points. So I am very thrilled by the collaboration in the future hydrogen community, because road transport will only be a fraction when it comes to the demand for hydrogen. The big guys out there will be the steel plants, and then mainly then those guys producing virgin steel. It will be cement, it will be in chemistry, it will be in other industries. So it will be a huge demand for green hydrogen. And for me, this was a little bit of the tipping point as well, for me as an individual, to believe in hydrogen for road transport. Because if we would have been the ones carrying everything, infrastructure, distribution, everything, then I think that it would have been a dead end. But we will be a fraction, less than 10%. This will happen. There will be hydrogen.
Yeah. I mean, it is also, I'm just waiting for that. I mean, the English phrase is for the penny to drop. But the idea of a big steel mill that is relying on buying a fuel, as in the propane or whatever, whether oil or the gas that they require to make the steel. So a lot, which is, as we know, volatile and variable. And then they go, well, actually, we can produce our own fuel on site.
Yes.
There's got to be long term, even with the investment for doing that, there's got to be a saving for them. So they're going to eventually end up being producing steel at a lower cost, because the feedstock is going to be lower, the fuel cost.
Yeah, and then, of course, then you have the intention to use green electricity. But then, since hydrogen is possible to store, you can also use this to balance the electrical grid. You can produce your hydrogen on Saturday evening, if that is then when the electricity price is low, in order to balance demand and supply in electrical grid as well. So it's a beautiful one.
But that is a very interesting, I'd never heard that actually expressed before, but the actual chemical structure of water is H2O. So there's two hydrogen molecules to every one oxygen one. So if you split it, you get more hydrogen. No one has ever stated that before. I mean, it's painfully obvious now you say it, but... So they presumably require one-to-one to heat their steel. They're using one unit of oxygen and one unit of hydrogen.
At least the relation is as it is, so they get surplus. And I don't exactly know if it's one-to-one, but it doesn't matter. They get a surplus.
Yes, they get a surplus, which is extraordinary, isn't it? That is amazing. And that is, I think, the critical thing for me. I mean, the thing that makes me just question sometimes the huge enthusiasm there is in the fossil fuel industry for hydrogen, and you go, yeah, that's good, except what they're talking about is what they now call blue hydrogen, which I think is a very interesting term for it, you know, i.e. steam from natural gas. So it is effectively a fossil fuel derivative, and that's, you know, you think, well, we've got to try and, that's the critical thing, is we've got to try and move on. And the technology exists. This is what always, get, you know, when there's things we can't do. I want to fly across the Atlantic in a battery-powered plane. Well, I'm not going to. The technology does not exist. But the technology does exist to produce hydrogen, to produce steel.
Yes.
I mean, that is, you know. It is as simple as that. But then, so give me something, because I know our audience love those sort of facts, like the car I drive currently has a 75 kilowatt hour battery. I cannot imagine how big the batteries are that you're fitting in trucks now that, I mean, I'm assuming can do somewhere between 150 and 200 miles on a charge. I don't know. What is their range? What is their battery size of a... What was it, a 26-ton, did you say, or a 24-ton truck?
What we have in production today is 26-ton.
26,
They say that you have around 400 kilowatt-hours on board.
Right.
So 400 kilowatt-hours on board. And it's very tricky, this, with expressing and promising range.
Yes.
You know, for a pass car, you know, What can differ in a pass car? It is if you go alone, if you have two passengers. But you know, in my industry, in my business, it's a very big difference if you go fully loaded or if you go empty, if you go in a very hilly topography or if you go flat, if you have a lot to stop and go, etc. But let's say the 300, 400 kilowatt hours, then you can drive, let's say, 200 to 300 kilometers easily then.
Right.
Next year, we will launch heavy-duty trucks, then up to 44 ton. Then we will then also use even more advanced batteries with higher energy density. So then we will get even more energy on board, 500 up to 600 kilowatt hours. And then you can then, but once again, depending on if you drive it with 44 ton, if you drive it as fast as you can. If you drive it in hilly conditions, then you will get lower range than if you drive with perhaps 28, 30 ton, like very many of our customers are doing. If you drive a little bit slower, if you drive in the Netherlands, where you don't
have that much,
then it's a perfect spot for electric truck. So the range is, to be honest, a variable in our industry.
Yeah. But that is good. So then if you are rapid charging that, I mean, these are kind of slightly silly questions, I admit, but I'm fascinated by them. But if you've got a 500 kilowatt hour battery and you are rapid charging it, I just can't imagine how the time works, but presumably it's going to take longer than a car. But if you're charging at 500, 750 kilowatts, it's got to be fast. I don't know.
But the thinking is like this, Robert, that let's say for those ones that come home to the depot, for those ones, or those ones sleeping in the truck, they can charge overnight. They can charge in the depot. The critical thing going forward, really to get the better electric trucks to take off in big volumes, will be because you have the driving time regulations where you're allowed to drive for 4 hours.
Right.
And then you have to have a break for 45 minutes. And then you're allowed to drive for 4 hours again.
Right.
And I mean, it will be beautiful the day when we can promise our customers that you can recharge during those 45 minutes.
Yeah.
But if you have 500 kilowatt hours on board or 600 kilowatt hours on board and you're rather low when you go in there, then you need to charge with 350 kilowatts or 500 kilowatts or 750 kilowatts or something like that in order to get it going then. And most likely for most customers, they don't need to go up to 100% perhaps.
No.
Could be sufficient to go up to 80% or something like that. But these 45 minutes, that is a really crucial point for the battery electric trucks takeoff. The day the industry can promise that, yes, don't worry, if you go in there, you know, with 20% battery capacity, you have your 45 minutes, and after 45 minutes, you can leave with 80%. That will be a game changer, but that's depending on the batteries. It's depending on the charging infrastructure.
Right. And I mean, that is a really critical difference between a private car and a truck. I mean, I've known about that for a long time because, you know, I often hear arguments from people who drive cars long distances, and they go, I drive, you know, for 12 hours nonstop in my diesel, whatever. And then you go, I don't believe them. One, I don't believe them because of this thing that human beings have called a bladder. And two, it's really dangerous. You know, you should stop. You get tired after a long time. And that's why that legislation for truck drivers is important.
Yes.
But it kind of, in a sense, it could lend itself, you know, obviously you need the infrastructure, you need the technology, but it could lend itself. It just works perfectly because in 4 hours in a truck, I don't know how far you go, 300 kilometers, maybe not even that.
Yeah, sort of.
Yeah. That's as far as you can go anyway. Yeah. So you don't need a 10 megawatt hour battery to drive 1,000 miles, do you? I mean, you've got to stop.
Yeah.
That is fascinating, really. Those differences are very big. But can we sort of finally talk about large plant? So I've had an electric digger. So the British company JCB made a small battery electric digger. Well, I used that to put in a power cable in my house. And by the end of the time, I was exhausted. I couldn't do any more digging, you know, because you are concentrating. I can operate a digger quite well. And I had to dig up a lot. And I had a drill thing that broke the concrete and, you know, all that stuff. So it was a tough day. No, I got nowhere near running out. The battery was fine for that day, and I plugged it in and it charged overnight, and I finished off the next day. So it had longer range than I have. But I'm sure a professional digger operator would probably need to charge it over lunchtime. But in terms of very big plant, that I can't imagine what sort of energy like a very large earth moving digger would use, a hydraulic, you know, with a big bucket.
But for me then, coming back, since we also have the construction machines in the group then, and we are working with technology, so my team, we are developing technology to be used across them for buses, trucks, construction equipment. And for smaller construction machines, we have already then started production of full electric compact excavators, compact wheel loaders, as you were into.
Yeah.
And gradually you will see more and more of the battery electric ones. But also in big heavy construction machines, we believe in fuel cell electric vehicles.
Right.
But the third element that we not have been talking so much about, Robert, and I know that you are very much into electric then, but I never miss an opportunity to state that there is a life for a combustion engine going forward as well. and we are seriously looking into the possibility of burning hydrogen in a combustion engine. By that, you wouldn't, per definition, get any carbon dioxide emissions, no greenhouse gas. So that can very well be a solution for the big, both the biggest construction machines and also from a trucking perspective, the truly heavy haulers, those one you meet, you know, during nights with special permission, you know, carrying extreme weights, etc. So we believe in all three technologies in parallel then, and a little bit the future will tell exactly the mixing percentages between them, a little bit depending on legislation, depending on infrastructure, energy prices, etc. But extremely happy to work in a company that has decided that we go for all the three ones, because I think the world needs all the three of them.
Yeah. And I mean, that is an intriguing thought I've not had before, because I have heard in fact, I live quite near the man who owns JCB, so I'm sort of very aware of him. But, you know, he's discussed at length the notion of using hydrogen in a combustion engine to drive large plant. But one of the things that suddenly struck me is ships. You know, I have made TV shows on huge container ships. And I asked the captain, who was a very nice man, how many gallons they used to make it work. And he said, you can't measure it in gallons. We measure it in tons. And it's, you know, it is such a vast amount of fuel that those things, and it's the dirtiest, it's called bunker fuel. And it's called that for, it's what's left when you've made diesel and petrol and everything else. But so they are so dirty. But you could possibly then run a huge marine engine from hydrogen. I'm sure it could be converted, or you could make a huge engine like that.
Or you turn the hydrogen into ammonia and you run very engine on ammonia, could also be an option. So that is really what the shipping guys are exploring, definitely.
Yes. Yeah. But that is, an exciting prospect to have all those, you know, the fact that you as a company are researching all those alternatives.
Yes.
And you're not, I mean, and that's what I feel has changed in the last 5 years is, not only the acceptance by the established automotive industry at varying levels, and I would, without trying to be too flattering, I would put Volvo at one of the more advanced companies. You know, you've really done, I've been very aware of what you've been doing. But it also is, there's a kind of acceptance that this is what we're going to do, you know, from Ford to General Motors to Toyota was another discussion, but Volkswagen, you know, very, very big companies going, okay, no, we're going to stop making combustion engines and we're going to develop other technologies. It does feel that. I mean, do you get that sense in the whole industry?
And for me, it's clear that I see a very clear move from the pass car industry more and more of them are stating that at a certain year, we will stop then selling combustion engines. But for me, when it comes to commercial vehicles, and you know, we have this division, you know, the Volvo Cars is a separate company. We have trucks, buses, construction equipment. But in our industry, in the commercial vehicles, I believe that there is a life for combustion engines also in the long run. So for me, it's a little bit dangerous with all those statements today, because all of a sudden it is some kind of truth out there that the combustion engine is dead. And we are a few fans behind it still, and we are making some noise whenever we can.
I think that's very honorable of you. And because it is definitely the sort of underlying motto that we use on Fully Charged is stop burning stuff. And we're about to do a whole show about that in time for COP26. But I've always said, I know we can't stop burning stuff completely, you know, but it's a good aim. And what you're talking about is for the vast majority of the machines you make and the technology you use, you don't burn anything.
No, absolutely.
And then there's certain exceptions where you will, but you're burning hydrogen, which is by any example.
Exactly, Robert. Yeah. I mean, for me, that's a beautiful mix.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So, I mean, when do you think then you will have a long range, heavy duty hydrogen fuel cell truck on the road? So you haven't got one of those yet. Am I right?
But we are building and testing vehicles then in our laboratory for test purposes. We have said clearly that fuel cell electric vehicles will be on the market in the second half of this decade.
Right.
So then towards the 2030, but well before 2030, then our customers will be able to place the first orders then. But long before that, of course, you will see different parts of our test fleet out there.
Yeah.
We always test together with real customers in real operations to get the real answers on the testing.
Right. And then this is really the last thing, because you've been very generous with your time, Lars. I do appreciate it. But what about, because I know you've developed some autonomous vehicles, I think mainly for kind of quarrying stuff. But is that something you're pursuing in terms of trucks and deliveries?
Oh, definitely. Autonomous driving. If there is anywhere where autonomous driving really will take off, then it is when it comes to commercial vehicles.
Yeah, yeah.
We see it a little bit also time-phased in three different segments. To start with, we call it the confined areas, as you were into, quarries, mines, you know, where you can fence it off. And everything is about safety, of course.
Yeah.
And in a confined area, it's rather simple to make sure that it is safe. And there we are rolling out solutions already today.
Right.
Next step will be what we call first mile. Think about port terminals, think about logistical centers, maybe to transport a container from a port terminal to a logistical center 3 kilometers away or something like that. Back and forth, from A to B, from B to A, from A to B to B to A, maybe on public road. Low speed, you know exactly where to drive. We can have maps, you know, down to the square millimeter. We can have cameras. We can put demands on infrastructure. Here we need to have a roundabout. Here we need to have a traffic light. Here you have to have a gate and so forth. That is not rocket science, but it is a huge leap, because you go on public road. On public road, anything can happen. Anything can happen.
Yes. Yeah.
But then the third step that we also truly believe in and are investing a lot in together with partners, it's to go on highway.
Right.
We call it the middle mile. So it's a little bit, you know, hub to hub, starting close to the highway, go up on the highway, not any highway, perhaps highway 21, perhaps from entrance 17 to exit 28 to start with only during night. You're only allowed to drive in the right lane and so forth and so forth.
Yeah.
This is a huge engineering challenge, huge.
Yeah.
But we believe that it will happen. We are investing a lot in this together with partners, and we believe that this will truly take off.
That is fantastic. No, that's very exciting. I do remember one of the things that Volvo were trialing, and this is a few years ago, was, I mean, I'm going to call it a train. So you have a driver in a truck, but then behind them, there are other vehicles that are linked to that vehicle, so as if they're in a train. Is that still something you're considering, or have you moved on from that?
You can say that is a little bit, let's say, in the same direction as the autonomous vehicles then. So that can be some kind of hybrid solution on the way towards. But the big thing is really when you can say, now we go autonomous, we are replacing the driver on the highway application. So that's what we are aiming for.
No, that is, I mean, those are things that are always, I find, really exciting and slightly terrifying. But, you know, I know that you will do it very safely. I mean, that's the thing, is that those terms for the general public, we never think about it. I think a lot of people understand last mile delivery, the man that brings your order to your house, or you see it at the shop or in the local town. But we never think, we're not exposed to the first mile. That's a really important, because I have filmed, I mean, it's a peculiarity of my experiences that I have filmed on big docks, big power stations, oil refineries, all these sort of places the general public don't go. So I have seen very bored drivers driving backwards and forwards with containers on the, you know, for hours and hours and hours. Not the most thrilling job, you know, very dull. So to get that, yeah, I can absolutely see that being fully automated. It makes real sense. Yeah, wonderful. Well, Lars, can I thank you, you know, for your input? That's been very exciting. And I mean, we will definitely be coming to Sweden at some point. next year, it would be really good. I'd love to see what you're doing, because it's so impressive.
It is impressive, and it is exciting, Robert. And I normally say that we have a lot of challenges ahead of us, a lot of this, if not all, has to be technology and engineering driven. So a lot of challenges, but also a lot of fun ahead of us.
Yeah. Well, I would think from someone in your position, you know, if you were doing your job, let's say 25 years ago, you're developing a slightly different designed fascia for the truck, or a different, you know, gearbox. But it was fairly, whereas now it's a fascinating, I mean, it's challenging, but really interesting what's going on.
No, but Robert, I have been into this industry now for almost 30 years. And I can be a witness to this journey. In the past, it was more of incremental development.
Yeah.
If you took the performance of the current vehicle, you extrapolated it a little bit, and you said that in 3 years we need to be here, and you wrote some kind of specification document to a new project, then you were not completely out of bounds. You were relatively good.
Yeah.
And today, it's disruptive for real. We are adding technologies to the buffet that we have never worked with before. We are taking bets like never before. So it's much more exciting. It's much tougher today, because you need to take decisions that can be right, that can be wrong. In the past, most of the decisions were right because you were in your comfort zone.
Yes.
So it's much more challenging. It is much more risky, but it is much more fun.
Yeah, yeah. That's fantastic. Well, you look and sound like you're having a good time, which is really, I love that. It's such a wonderful thing to experience. And I'm really grateful to you for your time today. That was really, really wonderful. So good luck with it all. I really can't wait to see the developments, and hopefully we'll speak again soon.
Sure. Thank you for inviting me, Robert. Take care.
Thank you. Obviously, I really can't thank Lars enough for that. It was really wonderful to talk to him. And hopefully one day we will get to go back to Sweden. We can drive there, you see, that's the good thing, to go and see what they're up to, because I just want to have a go in a really big hydrogen fuel cell digger. That's on my bucket list. It's on my bucket. I want to dig up some granite with hydrogen. That's what I really want to have a go at doing. One day, maybe we'll have a chance to do that. But that's all. So please do subscribe to this podcast feed on your favorite podcasting download app, or subscribe to the YouTube channel, Fully Charged Plus, and tell your pals and spread the word. And there's going to be lots more. Going to be a lot of stuff coming out of COP26. That's for sure. We're interviewing some impressive people who are attending the event. I can say no more at this point of time. Anyway, that's all. As always, if you have been, thank you for listening.